Lord, God bless you. Appreciate your gift of support, your prayers of support. We're going to go ahead and receive Pastor Hill, praise God, and as the Lord leads him in the word, hallelujah, indeed, hallelujah, we're going to receive this ministry. We thank God for all that should happen and has already happened here in Northside Christian Center. So let's see. You ready, Pastor? Okay.
We'll just use this, okay?
Praise the Lord.
Amen. The crowd looks like my Wednesday morning class. Amen. They in place too. Let me see them. All right, even Brother Galloway. He joined us last week. I'm excited. All right, we just praise God for all of you. Especially our guest, Apostle Smith, Christopher Smith, Brother Curtis's friend, and we just praise God for him. I understand he's an apostle, a great man of God, and we appreciate great men of God. Amen. Let's give him a God bless you. Hallelujah. And we also want to say that we appreciate the ministry of the Praise and Worship team. They were wonderful. Wonderful. All right, just so happy to see Sister Brianna back. And promise we're going to tie her down for this summer for a while, because we sure need it, don't we? If she has to leave, well, she just have to be good and ready when she comes back. Because we're going to turn this place out upside down. I just really believe that there's a whole lot that God is going to do in-house, and we won't have to be going and trying to get somebody else to do things that we can do ourselves if we would just, amen, just trust God. I'm just looking forward to, amen, we being self-contained here. Amen. And also, I want to just say that we appreciate Brother Joseph back with us this morning. Let's say amen. I missed him last week. And we understand the circumstances, but we are glad to have him back this morning. Amen. A wonderful young man and very gifted and very talented. Amen. It's kind of warm in here. I don't know why. See, y'all fanning, so y'all already tuned me. I'm just like, focusing on trying to keep cool. All right. Well, I just want to put a little bit on y'all. Would it be good to be out of here about it? About 1 o'clock? I mean, 11:30 or 12? I said, wouldn't it be good? Go home, give y'all plenty of chance to barbecue, smoke, you know, meat, and make your potato salad. All right. Thank you, brother. I'm glad you're here this morning. You said, take my time. Take my time. All right. Last week, we were ministering on something that we feel that is the key to real power and authority with God. And that was a subject that many times we don't hear today. And the importance of it is very, very pronounced, and that subject is love not the world. Love not the world. Amen. And, you know, that's somebody came to me last Sunday and said that, oh, you preach today like we used to hear in our old holiness church years and years ago. You will have to go way back to the older teachings in order to hear something about love not the world, come out from among them and be separate, and holiness without which no man shall
see the Lord. Those were the type of scriptures I was kind of reared on. I remember them very vividly, although it was 21 years. I was 21 years of age before I even gave the Lord my life, even though I was raised in a holiness church and went from the time I was came into this world, and I didn't get saved until I was 21. And how could you avoid salvation all of those years in a holiness church when in those days people came to you and, amen, and they were consistently reminding you, you need to be saved. You need to be saved. And they talk about hell a little bit, right? Amen. And I grew up in this church with that fear. I was always running scared because I knew that it took holiness and I wasn't ready to what? To live it. I felt like all of my fun would be completely what? Cut out, eliminated when I got saved. And I said, I don't want to be saved, not right now anyway, because I won't be able to do none of the things that I like to do. I thought I like to do. And so I just said, I'll get saved when I get old. Yeah. Amen. But the scripture says, remember now thou creator in the days of thy youth. Yeah. Yeah. For when the what? The evil days come now. May the years draw nigh when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure. Amen. So I got scared when I was 21 years old. I mean, I got really scared that Sunday, that day of the week, that lady prayed over me and she says, death today. Death, D-A-T-H. I thought she was saying I was going to die in that church that day. And I had been dreaming all these bad dreams that I died and I was in hell. You know, those holiness people, when they prayed and when they preached and talked and amen, you had some kind of fear. Fear of God. I mean, amen. So I constantly had that fear hanging over my life that I felt like that if I didn't get right, one day I was going to what? I was going to really reap the fruit of my doings. So the Bible says the way of a transgressor is what? It's hard. It's very hard. Amen. But the way of life, amen, is the way of peace. The Bible says that. The work of righteousness. Everybody just say the work of righteousness. The work of righteousness shall be what? Peace. And the effects of righteousness is quietness and assurance forever. Amen. So I got in the ark of safety after that woman prophesied that thing over me. But she was talking about another kind of death, spiritual death. You know, like spiritual death is everywhere in the church. People are spiritually dead. You know, you can be dead while you live. Is that right? They that live in pleasure are dead while they live. Amen. That means that they are what? Not connected. They are not hooked up. They don't know what's going on. Amen. So she was predicting, she was saying spiritual death. And I thought she was speaking about what? Natural death. So for the first time in my life, I lost my dignity. I lost my pride and all of my bashfulness, timidity. I lost all of that. And I opened my mouth as wide as I could. I've never would have considered opening my mouth before anybody at that stage of my life because I felt like that I just couldn't talk to people and I felt so bad about myself. So I just didn't ever entertain the idea . All right, this is Brother Daniel's family. That's it. Praise the Lord for them. I understand they're having a family reunion. All right. Well, we really appreciate them. We got to find out where the reunion is going to be. So we will. That's something you probably don't need to announce. You might have too many takers. That was the day the Lord saved me, and I tell you, I wouldn't take nothing for my life. When she said those words on me, I thought that was the last opportunity that I would have to get saved. And I opened my mouth as wide as I could, and I cried and hollered. Those days they call us holy rollers. And I rolled on the floor. Oh, I rolled. And as a result of completely yielding and submitting my life to the Lord saved me, filled me with the Holy Spirit, and I was in the Spirit about 3 hours. And when I got up, I knew something had happened. You know, sometimes people confess Christ or shake the preacher's hand and get their name placed on the roll book, and nothing happens. Is that right?
Right.
No, I just don't believe that you can just come and just shake the preacher's hand and just put your name on the roll book without something happening on the inside.
Amen.
If that was the case, you could actually go out to a barn, B-A-R-N. Some of y'all don't know what a barn is. That's where they keep horses. And you could write your name on the barn door and shake the mule's hand, foot, the mule's foot, and then you would become a mule if it was that easy. So if you could shake a preacher's hand and just write your name down on a roll book and you become a Christian, then the same logic to me, y'all might be smarter than I am, the same logic would be I could go out to a barn and just shake the mule's foot and would write my name on a barn door and become a mule. Some of y'all said, that don't make sense. Well, either one makes sense. All right, so I became a new creation in Christ, and I became a new creation. My life drastically changed. And amazing enough, after that experience and what had transpired in my heart, I noticed that I didn't have any inclination to do the things that I formerly were doing that I felt like were enjoyable. Amen. You know, someone said that you can, if you see a dog with a big bone, and he has a tendency to hold on to that bone, right? Until you throw him out a piece of what? Meat, something with substance, and he'll drop that bone every time. Amen. To get that big fat piece of what? Beef, meat. He'll do it every time. It's the same way in the kingdom of God. When you find out how good God is, and that peace that passes all understanding. How many know what I'm talking about? The peace that passes all understanding, and the joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. When you experience that, you just don't want to go back to the old way. Amen. You don't want to go back to that old slop. Amen. If any man be in Christ, he's a what? New creature. Old things. Everybody just say old things. Have passed away. Now if some of y'all find some of the old things more are exciting and attractive than the things in Christ. Amen. I sometimes question whether you got all that you need. I'm not saying you didn't get born again, you didn't get saved, but maybe you don't have all you need. Someone used to sing this song, all that I need is in Jesus. Amen. He sent his, come on, Sister Dorothy. You don't know that? Well, she ain't old enough to know that. Well, there's another song we used to say, can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like the Lord. Amen. So I have found completeness, wholeness, satisfaction, and all that I need in serving the Lord. How many have found that peace that passes all understanding? That joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. And I can go back now. I was barely 20, and I said, I don't want to be saved. I don't want to be a child of God, because it destroys all your fun. You can't have no more fun. All your fun is gone. But let me tell you, I have found real fulfillment, real joy in what? Serving the Lord. When I lay down at night, I don't have to worry about if I don't wake up where I will spend eternity. That used to be a real issue to me. Because I wasn't saved, my soul was not at rest. And I knew if I would go into eternity and wasn't saved, I knew what my destiny would be. So it kept me disturbed. Amen. I went to places of the world and tried to enjoy it, but I just couldn't kick in. I just couldn't kick in. My mother had taught us about love, not the world. Amen. I went to a movie, and some said, well, there's nothing wrong with movies. You know, that's debatable whether that's worldly or not. Whether it's worldly or godly, it's kind of debatable sometimes, right? But my other parents told us that these were worldly things. And when I went there, I just couldn't go into dances were worldly. And I just couldn't. Amen. I went to dances and tried to enjoy it. I couldn't enjoy it. Amen. I never could learn how to keep step. And I know some of y'all, amen, could really cut up out there on that floor. All right. But I never could learn it. So I guess those prayers were following, you know, my life. Tried to learn how to smoke and get into the worldly things like all the other boys. They look so cool smoking those smoke rings. Yeah, they look just so cool. I said, I want to be like that. And I got me some cigarettes. And I started smoking them. Boy, I got almost choked. I thought I was going to die. So I didn't mess with that no more. I didn't try that no more. That didn't work for me. So, but I see the joy even of living for Christ, and I just wouldn't ever want to go back to the old way. Amen. So I just want to say just a little bit more about the world. Now sometimes 1 John 2:15 through 16 just doesn't register with a lot of people. Love not the world. I mean, that means that we are not to build intimate relationships with the world. In other words, hang around. There's no way you can avoid. Jesus said, I pray not that you be taken out of the world, but that what? That you will be kept from the things that are what? In the world. So there's no way we can be kept out of the world. I mean, that can eliminate unless you die. You know, somebody asked Brother Hagin one time, pray for me that I will have no more problems and temptations and troubles. Just pray for me. She came to the preacher and asked him, pray for me that I won't ever have any more problems or trials or hardships. He said, well, sister, the only way I could pray, I had to pray that you died. So she changed her tune then. So in this world, you're going to have what? Tribulations. Is that right? You're going to have troubles, and you're going to have all types of things that's going to be coming against you to help squeeze you in its mold. But the Bible says we are not to be conformed to this world, but we are to be what? Transformed by the renewing of our what? Minds. So that we may prove that which is good. Amen. So let me just give you that scripture. 1 John, that's 2:14. It says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in it. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Father, add a blessing to the reading of the word, and let the hearers be partakers of that revelation that you will bring forth in these few minutes. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, now, how many would like to know what the world is? Okay, the world is this system. The system of all of the things that exist in our world that that entices you to, or influences you to really to become a part of that ideology or the way of thinking or the way of doing. It includes things like morality. The world has a standard of what morality. Kind of sometimes, if it feels good, do it. if it makes you feel good, do it. They don't have no real high sense of what standards of right and wrong. To some people, you can do almost anything as a believer and you feel okay. As long as you what? Consistently ask God to what? Forgive you. Amen. That's the way some people live their Christian life. Just like the man that used to come to church every Sunday and he said, Lord, remove all of the cobwebs out of my life. That means that he would consistently repeat the same sins over and over. And he would come in on Sunday and ask God to what? Forgive it. How many ever seen people that live their life like that? They never get victory. They've been struggling with the same problems for many, 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 many years and never, 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 amen, seek the Lord to get victory. The scripture says sin shall not have dominion over you. Amen. How many believe that? Sin shall not have dominion over you. And I think that if you are struggling with some type of challenge or habit that you can't break, amen, you ought to what? Turn that thing over to God. Amen. Get somebody to pray with you or help you or counsel you. Someone that will support you or lead you. Amen. Because the wages of sin is what? Death. And the Bible says they that are in the flesh cannot please God. They that are in the flesh cannot please God. So you don't want to live your life in the flesh, because the scripture says that the end of that is going to be what? Death. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. So all of these philosophies and values and different things, even in the education system, a lot of things are taught that are anti-what? God. And a lot of values that we used to hold on to, they are gradually what? Fading away because of humanistic what? Thinking. And people are getting away from the what? Clear instructions and admonitions of the Word of God. I mean, it is fading. I mean, even equality in marriage, gay marriage. People are proud. We're gay. Yeah, two men. Yeah, we gay. Amen. Two women. Amen. This is becoming a law in our land. It's all right for what? Two women to marry. It's all right for two men to marry. And these are the world's ideas. These are not God's standards. So we can't get caught up and let the world squeeze us in its mold, right? Amen. We got to what? Adhere to what God's standards are. We can't be caught up. The scripture says this, be not conformed. This is Romans 12:2. Be not conformed to this world. This is old time preaching, and if we preach it today, the church showing up will be empty. But we're empty enough now. Y'all barely can take a little bit that we're doing. But if we really preach holiness like we should be preaching it, you wouldn't have a whole lot of what? Takers. Because everybody want to kind of what? Live loose, live the way they want to live. Amen. But Romans 12:2, it says this, and this has been in here ever since I was born and before too. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Be not conformed. In other words, it's saying, do not let the world squeeze you into their way of thinking and the way of living. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Renewing of the mind is when you can build your spiritual life up to a point where spiritual values will really begin to what? Transcend all of the worldly values and ideals and ideologies. When you can really get built up to a point where you can say no to all of the things that's trying to what? Pull you down. Squeeze you into their way of what? Living, thinking. When you can say no to the flesh. Amen. But I'm telling you, that's a place in God everybody ought to want to be. When you can say what? No to the what? Flesh. Because they that live in the flesh, they can't what? Please God. Who want to live a life not pleasing to God? Jesus said, I always do those things that what? Pleasing to him. And that should be the pattern and the standard that we should be seeking. I always do those things. But you can't do it in the strength of your own ability. Amen. That man that said, Lord, remove the cobweb. Remove the cobwebs. He couldn't do it in the strength of his own ability. And somebody got tired of that man every week committing the same sins and coming back on Sunday and saying, Lord, remove those cobwebs. Amen. One sister heard it one time too many. She said, Lord, don't remove. Don't move those cobwebs. Kill that spider. Kill that spider. So I think renewing the mind is the ability to kill the spider. Y'all can remember that, right? Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not what? I, but it's the Christ that what? Lives in me. So you got to find the way to let Christ live the life through you. You got to step back because you can't do it in the strength of your own ability. But Paul said, I can do all things through who? Christ. Woo, glory. I can do all things through who? Christ. That what? Strengthens me. Amen. And you got to make confessions like this. Amen. I can do all things through Christ that what? Strengthens me. Amen. How many believe that the things that you say will actually dominate your life? You actually establish your world or your environment by the things that come out of your mouth. If you always say, just like the brother said, I can't live it, I can't live it. You know, sometimes people say, I sin, you sin, everybody sin, man is prone to sin, as the sparks fly up. Amen. You just can't live a life. You can't, I agree, you can't live a life free and separated from sin in the strength of your own ability. But the scripture says, I can do all things through Christ. That strengthens me. How many can say with Paul, I can do all things through who? Christ. That what? Strengthens me. That's what the Lord wants you, amen, to have coming out of your mouth consistently. Amen. How many believe that whatever you say, the Bible says the power of life and death is in your what? Tongue. If you keep saying it, one day you're going to believe it, right? And not only will you believe it, you're going to what? You're going to do it. That's the reason why Joshua was instructed to meditate, in other words, speak the word out day and night, so that you might be able to what? To what? Do it. Observe to do it. How many believe anything that comes out of your mouth and eventually will begin to what? Dominate your life. I'm getting happy right now. Because I know we James Hill years ago, boy, I was the hallelujah, the black sheep of my family seemed like. Brother said, you're born to lose. You'll never make it. Amen. But I have news for him. Amen. Hallelujah. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Amen. I found out that it wasn't contingent upon what? James Hill. James Hill wasn't about nobody or nothing. But it's a God on the inside of me. Amen. I count on God. Amen. How many just count on God, the God on the inside of you? If you let him have his way, if you let him be God, if you place him in a position where he can what, use your words. Oh, I'm getting happy now. Use your words. Amen. To what? To build yourself up. How many believe that you can build yourself up on your most holy faith? Amen. Hallelujah. Words are very powerful. Very powerful. You always want to agree with what God says about you, not what people say. Hallelujah. The Bible says the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. And then, you know, the world said, oh, no, you can't deliver yourself. You can't change your life by words coming out of your mouth. Amen. If they are God's words, and Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. Amen. God's word, they are what? Spirit and they are life. Y'all have to say that. God's word in my mouth, they are what? Spirit and they are life. Amen. That can do a whole lot to turn things around in your life if you keep the word in your mouth and let that word become a part of your what? Heart. Let it be, amen, get in your heart. Let it become a part of your everyday life. How many can say, I'm guided by the word of God? I live by the word of God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So that's the key. That's the secret of living an overcoming life. You got to get the word. You got to agree with God. If God says you can and you say you can, then you're not in agreement. Is that right? I'd rather believe God than believe my what? Believe myself or believe my fears. I don't say what I can't do. I say what I can do through Christ. It's not me. Not by power. Not by might. But it's by my spirit. So I trust. Amen. Y'all have to. Amen. If y'all don't agree with me, the word says, amen, all things are possible to them that what? Believe. I can do all things through Christ. And I believe all means all. I believe it means what? You don't have to love the world, neither be controlled or dominated by the world. Amen. Scripture says, come out from among them and be what? Separate. That's sanctified teaching. We don't call it sanctified because we should sanctify. People always want to put you in a word, certain church. But the Bible says, amen, come out from among them and be what? Separate. Amen. Now, the Old Testament really stressed that. The New Testament does, but it's in a different way. The Old Testament stressed that when people intermarried, like Jewish people intermarried with non-Jewish, that was forbidden under the Old Covenant. And they were not to mingle and develop close relationships with people that didn't have the same values, the same standards, and the same laws, the same moralities. They were not to do that. And the reason for that was because Joshua 23:13 says that it would be snares and traps and scourges in your side. That was the reason why God's people were not to live among the worldly nations and to get hooked in to a whole lot of the things that they were doing, because it said it would be snares and traps and scourges. This is Joshua 23:13. In your side and thorns in your eyes. In other words, that type of close fellowship would teach you to follow all of the detestable things that they do in worshiping their gods, and you will end up sinning against the Lord. So God admonishes people to not to get involved with nations that practice idolatry, that did detestable things. In other words, to avoid contamination in their mind. How many believe that your mind can be impacted by a whole lot of worldly and nasty and ugly stuff going around you? If you can get away from it, you need to what? Flee it. Is that right? But if you just, every time, amen, somebody got something going, here you are, showing up, want to be what, in the midst of everything, you don't care. Amen. That's not good. You know, y'all know the example of Lot and Abraham. Abraham and Lot had to separate because of their riches, their cattle. I mean, Abraham and Lot got so big until the land was not able to contain all of their what assets. So they had to what separate. And when the time came for them to separate, Lot, even Abraham said, brother-in-law, was it his brother-in-law? Nephew. Okay, he said, you pick, here's Sodom and Gomorrah. Here's the big city lights. Amen. The strip clubs and all the lights in the clubs and the good time and the joints and everything. Bob, he was beautiful. He's like, here it is over here. And if you choose over here, then I'll go over here. But if you choose over here, then I'll go over here. And Lot saw all of the what? The fun and the flashiness and all of the what? The pleasure. I mean, all of those enticing things. He knew it would be a lot of fun over in Sodom.
Yeah.
So the Bible says Lot pitched his tent to it. You wanted to be a mix of what? Fun and pleasure. All right, Abraham said, well, I'll just go over the country. Amen. Take care of my sheep and oxen and all of my animals and stuff, and let you go. So they, and the Bible says that over in Sodom, Lot was vexed by the conversation of these wicked folks day and night. Is that right? 2 Peter, that's what it said. Just turn over there. So that shows you God don't want you what? Courting the world and hanging around the clubs, pretending like you want to go to what? Get somebody saved. you just love the world. You want to go and get somebody saved. You're going to get nobody saved at a club. I doubt it. Because more than likely you ain't had to save yourself. Amen. And it ended up with what? Squeezing out the little bit of Jesus you got. All right, 2 Peter 2:7-9. I'm telling you, we are not to build intimate relationships with people that don't have the same value. In other words, hang around with them and joke and tell all these lies and listen to all of that mess that they talk about. Sometimes every other word is a curse word. They talking about everybody far and near. Every woman that they ever been with, or every man that they ever slept with. They talking about all of that crap, and here you are, amen, you struggling already trying to what? Hold on to the Lord. And you're just what? Just sucking it all in. Bible says what? Flee that kind of stuff. Get away. Come out from among. That's what I mean. You can't avoid folk now. I mean, sometimes our spouses are not saved. You just can't move out, right? Right? If you're on a job and somebody, your lead man or your supervisor is a immoral person, just can't what, walk away. But you don't have to hang with them during lunchtime, do you? You don't have to go to their parties on the weekends, do you? Look how y'all look at it. So I'm saying, that's the what we're talking about. We ain't saying you're trying to what, avoid folk. But Jesus said, I pray not that you be taken out of the world, but that you be what? Kept from the evil that's in the world. So in order to be kept from evil, you have to what, separate yourself as much as you can from all of the vices that will really contaminate your what? Mind and your spirit, your walk with the Lord. And secondly, you gotta do more than just separate yourself, but you gotta get something in you. Is that right? You gotta the Bible says, be ye transformed by the renewing of your what? Mind. That you may prove, you gotta what? Get enough word. That means you gotta come to Bible study. Come to Bible. Y'all don't like that. Come to Bible study. 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 Come to Sunday school. Everybody need to be in Sunday school and Bible study and prayer. And then you see after about a few months, you begin to what? Start thinking different about a whole lot of things.
Hallelujah.
Amen. That worldly grip on your life will begin to what? Dissipate. You say, well, I don't like that gin as well as I used to like it. It's losing it. I don't like it. It used to turn me on, but now it doesn't do anything. I think I just cut it loose. Amen. That's the word work. The Bible says, lay aside all superfluity of naughtiness and receive with meekness the engrafted word of God, which is able to save your soul.
Yes, amen.
The word of God always has a transforming effect on your life.
Yes.
And that's the way it happened to me. Boy, I was really in the world. I was trying to be popular, running a few women and catching them. That was before we were married now, before I was saved. All right, but when I got saved, I began to realize, I said, man, things are different now. All I want is Jesus. I mean, my heart, I was just, I went to bed, amen, just crying and weeping, just loving Jesus so much. I read the Bible and just cried. The Bible was just so good to me. And I was teaching school my first year, just before we got married, and after we got married, I forgot that's been so long. I guess you forgot too. And I always try to find a church. I was living away from home by 50 miles. I always try to find a church during the week where I could go and pray with people that believed in prayer. And I would go and pray and fellowship with them. And when I came back home on Friday, I went to church again. And so, I mean, it was the word was just gradually squeezing out of me all of that desire and all of that old mess and stuff that was what wrapped up on the inside of me. So I know what the power of God can do.
Yeah.
I know what the power of God can do. So Lot, and how did Lot turn out? The Bible says his soul was what? Vexed. That's the reason why you got to separate yourself. You got to separate yourself, get away from it, flee fornication. The Bible says avoid fornication, abstain from fleshly lust, which wars against your soul. And it says, another scripture says, they have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And the Bible also says, if any man loves, is a friend of the world, he's going to be an enemy of God. And 2 Peter 1 and what? Yeah, what does it say?
Yeah, about Lot.
And deliver just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelleth among them, and seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds.
Okay. So y'all see that he was in the midst of all of that mess? The Bible says day and night his soul was just what? Vexed with the things that he what was seeing and the things that he was hearing. And he was a righteous man.
So that shows that God doesn't want you to what? Building these intimate relationships with what people that's got all of these values that's worldly, that's satanic, and that doesn't meet the criteria that God, amen, is admonishing us to live up to in the scripture. So that's the reason why God says, come out from among them. You're going to be, it's going to war against your soul. Sin and evil deeds, things you see and hear. And you don't have to turn the television on to what? To try to find something that's going to what? War against your soul. That's going to vex your what? Vex your spirit day and night. How many know you can just turn the knob? Turn the control. Flip the switch. I flip the channel. And you can find something that will vex your soul. I ain't got nobody, amen, said amen right now. So you ain't got to go to Sodom. You ain't got to go all the way back to Sodom. It's been destroyed anyway.
You just what? Flip your TV on. You can find something that will what? Vent your soul. And you know you can't be watching pornography. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
They said 60% of Christian men are watching pornography now. 60%. And y'all know that ain't godly, is that right? All right, so the Bible is still speaking about what? Holiness. Everybody say holiness.
Holiness.
See, holiness is what? Separating yourself from all of this stuff that's going to mess you up in your mind. Because if you're afraid of the world, you won't be no afraid of God. How can two walk together unless they be agreed? You have to choose whom you're going to serve. Amen. And there's a reason why God wants us not only to separate ourselves, but he wants us to build up ourselves so that we can have two ways that we can defend ourselves against worldliness. You can defend yourself by what? Not being around as much as you possibly can. Avoid it. Is that right? Does that make sense? Avoid as much as you can. Does that make sense to anybody?
Yes.
And then you need to what? Be not just active or retroactive. You got to not only be avoiding it, but you got to what? You got to take action that will build you up to the point where you won't be enticed. Proactive, okay, proactive. That's what I wanted to say. That's good to have a good help me. Proactive. Okay. How many believe that being proactive is important? That means that what? You don't run from Bible study or watch TV on Bible study time. I didn't get a single amen that time. Come from prayer. Amen. When prayer times come, amen, you can't be found with a search warrant in terms of that church. Now, how can you build yourself up where you won't want to have a desire to engage in things that are what? Worldly. When worldly things come, if you ain't built up, if you are not renewed, if the spirit man hasn't been what? Cultivated and developed and really fed, what will happen is that what? You're going to be enticed to what? To follow the line of least resistance. How many know any old dead fish can float downstream? But it takes a lab on the float upstream. You got to have some in you. All right, I'm about done. That's the reason why God has us, even tells us to do these things, because Jeremiah 5:25, it costs good things to be withholding from you. He's not just trying to destroy your fun, but he's trying to place you in a position, if the scripture says, that God won't withhold no good thing from them that will what? Walk upright before him. God wants to get the good thing. How many know that God got rules? Y'all had rules in your household, right? If you had kids that wouldn't obey your rules, they just wouldn't get the what? The things they want. Amen. Shouldn't God more so have rules and standards? He says that the Lord God is a sun and shield. He gives grace and glory. No good thing will be withheld from them that what? Walk up right before him. That's the reason why God wants you to be have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness. Come out from among them. He doesn't want you contaminated and messed up in your heart and spirit. Is that right? And your heart, your mind vexed day and night. And you don't have no peace, no joy because of what stuff you were involved in. And you think you're going to receive the blessings of God? Oh. All right. Well, so much for that. Let me move on. Now, a good example, Solomon, God told him, he said, Solomon, that was one of the visions that he had. He said, if you would do right and keep my commandments and stay clear of all of these heathen women and don't go down to Egypt and buy horses for profit. He told him several things to do. And after 20 years, 20 years, his kingdom went to being the most glorious and powerful and prosperous
kingdom in the history of the nation of Israel. You won't find anybody. I mean, that man was just impeccable with knowledge, wisdom. People came from thousands of miles just to hear the wisdom of Solomon.
Yes.
20 years he flourished. He reached his pinnacle.
Yes.
And after then, he began to what? Flirt with the world and began to what? Do the very things God told him not to do. And how many women did he end up? How many concubines and wives? 300. How many wives? One was 300, the other one was what? 700. I don't care what order they, what was the order of them. 1,000 wives and concubines. That's too many. And God told him that if you begin to get involved with all of these foreign wives and women, you're going to end up what? Kneeling down, worshiping their idols. That's exactly what happened to him. And the Bible says Solomon's heart was not perfect before the Lord any longer, because the very thing that God told him not to do, amen. So God had to what? Had to break his what? Covenant to a great extent to Solomon. And we find no record that Solomon ever got right with God. Out of all of those years of just pleasing God, he was advocating he was wise and he was a great man. All right, so that's the reason why God doesn't want you what? Because it will squeeze all of what? All of the word, the values, the morality, and it'll place you in a position where you can't receive from God. Because the Bible says if a man's heart, it condemns him, then he cannot have what? Confidence. And he can't get his prayers answered no more. So that's the reason why God wants us to not only separate ourselves from evil, but he also wants us to what? To build ourselves up so that we will have enough in us to say no. When the devil comes and waves his little sign, he says, skip club. You say no. Pornography. No. Lying.
Amen.
Adultery.
Amen.
No, you can't. I mean, this is, somebody says, easier said than done. You got to have something in you when these temptations begin to what? Hit you from every direction. Sometimes you might get weak, is that right? No, nobody ever get weak. Well, when you get weak, the Bible said, let the weak say I'm strong. You got to start, if you feel yourself getting weak, you better get something coming out of your mouth quick that talks about strength, and talk about the Lord. You can just say, Jesus, 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 and get strength, right? The Bible says the name of the Lord is a strong tower. You can just call on the name of the Lord, and whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, the Bible says, they shall be delivered. You ain't got no excuse. God's grace is what? Sufficient. The Bible says he's able to cause all grace to abound toward you, so you will have sufficiency in everything. You got what it takes if you got the Lord. If you got the word. If you got the word in your mouth. And the Bible says that when you put it in your mouth, you got to hold fast to your confession of faith without wavering. Amen. How many know? Amen. If you will be patient, amen, and just keep what? Hold, amen, what you got. And ask the Lord for more. Amen. You can get beyond the temptation, right? The Bible says no temptation has ever what? Taking you that's not coming to man, but God is what? Faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above what you're able, but will with the temptation make a way for you to escape. You know how he has for you to escape? Amen. Say no to the devil. Another way, get away from it. Flee. How many believe that you can avoid a whole lot of stuff if that's just by fleeing? The old man, not old as I am, I can flee. Everybody can flee, right?
Come on.
that you got to have something in you.
Come on.
You got to study the word, right? You got to know the words. Bible says, you shall know the truth.
Yes.
Amen. If you continue in my word, everybody just said, the power is in continuing. Amen. See, if you would just get in the word, I mean, all these curse words wouldn't be coming out of your mouth.
Amen.
Amen. You wouldn't be searching the channel. You'd be flipping the channel. Trying to find something ugly. Something that will satisfy your what? Oh, fleshly what? Desire? Oh, you would just say what? No. You would say, the Lord is the strength of my life. Amen. Greater is he that is in me. And how many believe that your words can deliver you? I know a whole lot of people have come to me and said, Pastor, this temptation came, all I just said was Jesus. 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 Amen. So God has a way for you to escape if you want to escape. Amen. If you want that spider kill, how many want that spider kill? So I'll say, well, I like my spider. You better get out of the cobweb business. And get into the what? Spider killing business. All right, let's say amen.
Amen.
Let's all stand. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.